Episode of the Full Nerd Radeon 500 series. What the hell am I talking about? Ryzen 5 and EVGA. In this episode of the Full Nerd Radeon 500 series, Ryzen 5 and the kick butt EVGA 1080 Ti. Welcome to the Full Nerd, episode 21, recorded on April 21st, 2017. I'm Gordon Ma-Ung with co-host Brad Charkas.
Heyo.
And reviews editor Elena Yee.
Hey, everybody.
And, of course, controlling the vertical and horizontal is Adam Patrick Murray.
Hey, Gordon, I have a question. Did you have a good vacation last week?
Yeah, actually, I did, except there was no cell service. You know, I use Verizon, which I...
Yeah,
I
me was, too.
I read that Verizon lost like 300,000 customers or something like that.
400,000, I think.
No, why? But they gained them back because of their unlimited plan. But I'm a Verizon customer because it works everywhere. It does actually mostly work everywhere, but we're on this island out in the Pacific, and there's no cell signal whatsoever. Except there were some other people like, hey, my T-Mobile, I got 3 bars. Like, T-Mobile has 3 bars. Why am I paying all this for Verizon, right?
They have no competition on that island.
I guess so. Like, they wanted the squirrel population. Like, John Laguerre's like, get the squirrels there. But sir, they don't have phones. Get it anyway. Yeah, it was crazy. So, no, that sucked.
Nice.
No.
Well, good to have you back.
No internet, no nothing. I did bring an AM/FM shortwave radio, though, just in case we went to war and we were stranded on the island. But, you know, we didn't.
So. In true
did
Gordon
fashion. Did you
bring
a Swiss Army knife, though? That's the question.
What? Oh, yeah.
He's got like 24 different knives on him at any time.
Yeah, he had to. And there's so much gear. So much gear.
He's prepared.
It was like car camping, except actually making 6 trips to the... We took a ferry over, and then everybody had to carry, 5,000 pounds of gear to the campsite. So it was really...
Nice.
And then the park service is like, oh, you can't bring folding, collapsing carts. Can't do that.
Weird.
Yeah, no 4 wheels. Oh, okay. And we get there and somebody has one. They're like, why do you, how, they said you could have that? Like, yeah. They're like, oh, that's a cool idea. So, yeah.
It's called discrimination,
fun.
Gordon.
That was fun.
It's called discrimination. That's what happens.
Yeah. Yeah. And they had these, it's the last thing. They warned us about the foxes. This is the Channel Islands, Santa Cruz Island specifically. They warned like, these foxes, keep your stuff locked up. They will, if you leave your tent zipped low, they will stick their snouts in. Open the zipper up. Oh. Go inside and eat any food in your tent if you have any. If not, they will mark it, which means they pee all over your stuff because they want to mark it.
Nice.
But it turned out that actually these foxes really were totally weak. They're like cartoon foxes. They look like, you know, those animals, the alley cat with the tail with the Band-Aid. And the, they were like, you could not, like one Oakland raccoon could take on like 25 of these foxes. They're just like, they're worthless.
Specifically Oakland.
Oakland street raccoons.
Oh, Oakland street raccoons are, man, they're dangerous.
Nice.
They're strapped.
Nice.
Everybody knows, if you understand what I'm talking about.
They also have budget video cards.
And budget video cards. Yes, I'm going to see that. He's totally taking us off. Sorry, let's talk about what you're here for. First up, now, I got to say I've been testing other stuff, so I've not kept up on the reviews. But, Brad, I understand this is a new brand of AMD cards, and I've heard on Reddit, it's the Rebrandion or something? The Rebrandion 500 series?
That's kind of rough. I mean, basically, it's not Vega, right?
What? I saw the picture. It's going to be Vega. It's going to be Vega.
How it starts. Oh,
almost got you.
Radeon RX 500 series. So, for a large part, it is basically the same as the RX 400 series, but they get a little bit more performance and they use a lot more power, right? So AMD refreshed all its Polaris lineup this week from the 580, 570, 560, and 550. The 550 is a brand new card. The 580, which I have one right here, Sapphire 580.
Wow.
It is basically, you know, it gets 3 or 4 frames per second more than an overclocked 480, but it uses a lot more power.
Well, Of course, overclocked. What about a stock 480? So, because certain. Well, I guess there are there reference. Are there reference 500s?
There are no reference 500 series cards, so I didn't feel it was fair to compare reference 480 versus an overclocked 580. So I compared an overclocked MSI Gaming X 480 that I had against this. You know, two or three frames, four frames more per second. Not bad. Little boost. Same deal with the 570. Little boost. Right. They're pretty much the exact same cards, which is kind of disappointing if you're waiting for Vega, waiting for new AMD cards. But they're still good enough to be the best in their price point, right?
So that doesn't change your opinion, because I know you prefer the four. You have preferred the 480 as the sort of like mid-range kind of budget card, right?
I still do. And they actually dropped the price of the 580, the starting price, down another $10. So it starts at 170 now. So I think that makes it a really great option for 1080p gaming. I still think the 4 gigabyte 580, sorry, getting numbers confused in my head, is probably the best option for most people because it does so much. It could do everything the 480 did, just, you know, a few frames faster.
Right. So there's no reason to buy a 480 at this point unless you want a reference card or something.
Actually, you should buy a 480 at this point, or you should buy a 470 at this point, because it pretty much is the exact same performance with less power. And at this point, if you can find any of them on sale, I mean, if you can save $30 or $40 buying a 480 instead of a 580, do it. That was my bottom line of my reviews. The really interesting part about the RX 500 series, though, are the cheaper cards. Because let's start with the RX 560, which is replacing the RX 460. It's not coming out till early May, so it's another few weeks away. I'm not exactly sure. And the interesting thing there is that the RX 460 was never the full-fledged version of that graphics processor. It always had two compute units disabled. But the RX 560, in addition to an overclock, is enabling those final two. So there could very well be a decent jump in performance there, enough to push it past the NVIDIA 1050.
And the 560 is how? What's that price in it?
Starting at $99 for the 2 gigabyte version. There will also be a 4 gigabyte version, which with those low end cards, never buy the 4 gigabyte version because it's just a waste of money. Anything you're going to be able to do with them isn't going to use 4 gigabytes.
So the 580 is sort of like a 1080p very high ultra card, right?
I would say it's like screaming awesome, very high ultra 1080, but it also does pretty good 1440. Okay. I mean, you can hit high 1440 in a lot of games. Not, I wouldn't say universally, but it's a really good 1440p card too.
What about VR? What about VR? Did you test any VR with this stuff?
I ran the Steam VR benchmark test. They're basically the same cards that they were before, just a little bit faster. So I didn't feel like it was worth going through extensively with them. The 480, I would still say, is still the baseline for VR. So the 470, they're selling as a VR ready card, and it very well might be, but I would spend that extra $30 just to be sure. Cause if you get a card that doesn't hold up well in VR, you're going to puke all over the place. So
yeah. And we've tried that. So. The 570 is, so if the, sounds like the 580 is an ultra 1440, you know, somewhat 1440 to 1080p card. 570 is like a straight 1080p, very high to ultra then, I guess, on that one.
Yep. Yep.
How does the 560 clock in? Because I'm wondering, because most people are running 1080p. You have to crank it down to medium or very high at that point, or high?
Yeah, we haven't tested it yet. That one's not coming out until May. But okay. The 460 did medium settings at 1080p. At 60 frames per second, or if you don't mind console quality frame rates, it could do ultra at 30 frames per second.
Why are you looking at me for?
Just, no,
that's good. It's a $100 card, right?
If you can match really nice console
with a $100 card.
Sorry, we cut over you, Brad. We were talking about Alina's really nice glasses.
I mean, Gordon was just throwing shade.
That's but, Gordon.
So yeah, so but $99 gets you a 1080p medium. That's not that ain't bad. It sounds like.
Yep. Or ultra, if you don't mind console frame rates, which a lot of people don't. That's not bad for, you know, double digits.
Oh, come on. Let's not.
Not Gordon.
Oh, you're trolling Gordon not, here. He's, you know,
you're just stabbing him in the heart with that.
He's cramping up.
Well, yeah. What about the
this is more interesting. This is a 550. Huh. This is half of a 460, basically. So a 460 has 16 compute units. Cut it in half. This has 8, right? So it's targeted very, very, very much so at esports players, And at people who want to boost up a home theater PC,
right,
with modern media codecs and stuff that, you know, so this is cheap. This is $80. It's a very interesting card. I loved it while I was testing it. I fell in love with it because I slipped it in there. I was playing League of Legends. I was playing Dota. I was playing CSGO. And I was easily clearing 100 frames per second at 1080p, which you definitely can't do with integrated graphics. And then AMD told me the price.
Uh-oh.
$80. Ooh. And $80 is not an expensive graphics card. But when the RX 460 is $100, and this is half as powerful for $80, it just makes that kind of hard to swallow. If this was $70, $60, I'd be all over this. It could have been something special. But I think it's priced a little bit too high right now.
That, huh. Yeah, I mean, that doesn't make any sense. $80, $20 more gets you twice the performance.
Well, I mean, in that budget range, maybe they're trying to go after the people who are just shaving those dollars as best they can. So they're like, well, if I can save $20, then I'll save $20. But you're just super limited at that point.
If you know, like, you're just going to use it to play Dota 2 all the time, or you're just going to slap it in a home theater PC, save the $20. Why not? But, I mean, that bare differential really cuts into its appeal for me. I was loving this card as I was testing it, and then I saw the price and shook my head a little bit.
Is that just simply MSRP? Can we expect street pricing to be $60? Because, man, it seems like to get that kind of performance for $60 is pretty nice. That's like the original, you know, or
Maxwell would be pretty sweet.
You know. Yeah, that'd be pretty awesome for $60.
I'd hope so. This is a huge step up over integrated graphics if you're playing esports too. So it's a definitely worthwhile card if you're into that.
Yeah, and I guess the idea is you slap that into any old POS box, right?
Because it doesn't require external power, right?
Yeah, no 6-pin on there.
Nothing on this. The first
Prove
wave.
It. Let me
the,
see.
Okay. The first wave of RX 460 graphics cards. All of 550 graphics cards all reuse 460 coolers, right? Because it's, you know, low end. So the first wave, they're just reusing what they already made. But there's already, I was just looking at it before the show started, XFX has announced low profile, ultra thin cards for home theater PCs and whatnot, and mini ITX machines. So there's going to be some really interesting form factor things going on with that soon.
Yeah. And I guess, you know, I mean, for me, I like it's a deal for $20 more. I get twice performance, but that means you have to step up to a 6-pin, right? I mean, a 6-pin power connector.
Have to with a 460, with the 560 coming out now, and looking at the way power's increased from the 400 series to the 500 series, I wouldn't be surprised if the 560 needs a power connector.
Huh, okay. Yeah, so that could be a deal breaker for
that
people.
That also changes the game a bit.
Yeah.
It's not just a price thing.
It's really interesting, I think, with this generation, how with the 400 series, AMD's big thing was, look, we're, you know, so much more power efficient, blah, 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 blah. You know, we're doing so good, you can power the 480 on a 6-pin power connector, so on and so forth. And now with that was the big deal with the motherboard, with the drawing too much power from 6-pin connector, which AMD fixed right away. But I find it really interesting that just this generation, they're like, nope, screw that. You know, we're going to power this up as much as we can and get every bit of performance we can out of it. This Sapphire card doesn't have a 6-pin power connector. It doesn't have an 8-pin power connector. It has an 8-pin plus a 6-pin power connector, which you never saw on any of the 480 boards. So,
Elena had a question.
I did. I was going to ask Brad something, but I think we should finish this first.
That 580, that Sapphire 580 is 8 plus 6?
Yes. The 6-pin, they say, is optional. I didn't test it, but you're starting to see a lot more cards. I have an ASUS Strix that I also have to review probably next week, drowning in graphics cards. And it has an 8-pin power connector as well, which those were pretty rare with the initial 480s. So
a 1080 will run on a 6-pin, if I recall, right? That's.
I don't know.
I think a reference, you know, / Founders Edition 1080 is a single 6-pin.
Well, I have an overclocked GTX 1080 Ti here, which we'll get to later. Hmm. And it also uses an 8-pin and a 6-pin. Spoiler. So.
Right. But that is considerably more.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we don't want to get on to that yet, but we're going to keep the green and the red here.
This ties into my question, actually, Brad. So given that phenomenal, in my opinion, kind of jump in terms of power requirement, are you getting anything more than just what you said, 3 or 4 frames per second Like, nope. Are there any other software? No.
I don't test with, you know, graphical compute. I focus solely on PC gaming, and across the board, everything I tested, it was four frames per second.
Sorry, I meant like any like extra features that unlock when you go up to the 500 series. Like,
nope. They are promoting a feature that showed up in their Radeon Crimson drivers called Radeon Chill, which in a whitelisted selection of games, 19 games, very popular games, if you activate Radeon Chill in those games, it can dramatically bring down temperatures and power usage by doing tricks about dynamically lowering the frame rate by tracking your mouse movements. But that's not new. That came out with Radeon Crimson software. It's available for RX 480 cards, so on and so forth. And it actually does work wonders. It's really, really good. I've used it. I've seen temperatures drop dramatically. And I didn't notice a big detriment to gameplay, but it's not new.
We do have a couple questions from the chat. First up, our buddy Sai is in. So,
hey, Sai.
Sorry he woke up a little late. The new face of Radeon Gaming, Sai.
Yes.
But yeah, we got a couple questions. Will Vega have mid-range cards? Do we know anything?
It depends on your definition of mid-range. That changes for everybody, but I would say that since this just came out, there wouldn't be anything from Vega below this, below a 580, right? I wouldn't be surprised if there was a 1070 competitor. I would hope so. So yeah. If you consider that mid-range, maybe.
A more relevant question from Paulo.
Looks like Gordon wanted to say something.
No, I was going to say, we don't know, but you can imagine there won't initially be mid-range, but as yield comes out and they flesh out the line, there will be a mid-range card eventually. And then we have no insight into this. We're just guessing, but...
Yeah,
the old patterns hold. I mean, I've never seen a launch where they did not eventually turn the die into a mid-range part. So,
good question from Paulo on YouTube. How's the driver stability on the new 500 series?
I had no issues with the launch driver. AMD gets knocked a lot for its drivers, but over the past year and a half, 2 years, basically since they became Radeon Technologies Group, they put a lot more focus on the software. And they've been pumping out, you know, day one drivers a lot more often. Their drivers are a lot more stable. I have no complaints about either AMD or NVIDIA drivers these days.
Nice. A pointed question from Bryant. So between the 480 and the 580, which one should he get?
Depends on the price and probably what kind of power supply you have in your system, right?
Which one is cheaper?
The day before the 580 came out, you could find 480s at very, very awesome prices, like as cheap as $170, $160.
Wow.
But as soon as the 580 came out, they kind of raised them.
Really?
So, yeah, I've noticed those sales kind of disappearing once the 580 came out. So if you can look around and find a 480 for cheaper, if you can save $30 to get, you know, 3 less frames per second, I would do that all day, every day. So,
but I guess I'm going to imagine the prices were low to clear out inventory, and now that they've cleared out the inventory, it's just probably harder to find a 4 series card.
That, and I'm guessing they don't want to distract from the launch, right? Because you don't want to have your new card come out and everyone be distracted by this better price on the older version. Because they're going to buy that.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised just from looking at sales over time that, I don't know, I'm just ballparking here, give it like maybe a month or so, and then maybe the 480 might go back down again just because they actually do want to clear the inventory. Yeah. But it might not go back down for a little bit because, yeah, right, Brad. Like, remember I was sending you all those links constantly where I was like, yep. Hey, look at this deal. Hey, there's another one. Hey, there's a third one.
You could get at one point a 470 for $120, one of them you sent me, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome for a gaming, you know, an entry level mid range. You know, build it. That's just lot of performance for the money. But
I
got
to ask. If there's any more questions, I gotta toss one thing out real quick that I forgot to talk about and I think is important. It's important that AMD did not position these as replacements for the 480, even though 400 series, even though that's what we're comparing them to. NVIDIA does the same thing. They're saying these are good cards for people who are upgrading from older things. So if you have a 380, a 960, 760, you know, an older card, then they're saying this offers a lot more performance in modern media stuff. So I think the real reason this series came out now is so that they have new Radeon 500 cards to sell with all the people buying Ryzen 5 processors, right? So people are buying Ryzen processors. They're looking to build new PCs. I think the whole reason this series is here is so that it's a little bit better, but really so that there's new cards for those Ryzen 5 systems.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was going to ask you. Is like, I don't even understand why they bothered to rebrand, you know, again, you know, that Reddit, you know, rebrand you. Yeah, that works on people, right? So, but
Ryzen 5 and Radeon 5, peanut butter and jelly, right?
It does. I got to admit, it does go over really well. It's a great segue, but actually, I did want to ask another upgrade question because, I mean, I do, because you pointed out the weirdest fallacy about all people who love components, right? We all love it, but everybody does this to everybody. Every single product is like, wow, well, this doesn't give you 30% more performance than the last product. You know, I mean, that does happen though, but generally, right? I mean,
yeah, it does. I think the next generation of cards that we see will be another big improvement, right? Because the next, it will be Volta and Vega or whatever's after Vega, Navi or whatever. The problem is we got really, really spoiled with the 10 series and the 480s. Not problem, it's great. And the 400 series, because we were stuck, the industry was stuck on 28 nanometer manufacturing process for so long that for 5 years, there's just mostly iterative updates, right?
Right.
And then both AMD and NVIDIA switched to 14 and 16 nanometer technology process, which gave them huge, huge leaps in performance. So that's what the last generation was. So to see it just kind of reused is kind of like, you know, not excited.
Yeah, I kind of wonder, like, I mean, you know, clearly we're going to be stuck on 14 nanometer for a long, long time. When we went from four, like on the NVIDIA side, going from 4 series to 5 series and 6 series, were they quantum leaps? They were kind of like, they were decent upgrades, yeah. Right? 15-20% sometimes more than that. I don't remember exactly, so.
Yeah, something like that. When you're not changing the underlying process technology, right, there's only so much you can change, right? You can make it more efficient. You can, which efficiency is what makes more performance, because you can do more with less or the same amount, basically. So those giant leaps are not typical. But this is, don't get me wrong, it's not rebrandion. These are definitely, especially on the lower end, the 560 and 550 are pretty decently new. And to increase the clock speeds on the other one, I would call it more of a refresh than a rebrand.
Okay. You know, I'm going to ask this just because I want to ask, you know, because I was, can you crossfire an RX 480 with a 580?
I think I know what I'm doing Monday. I'm going to try. I would think so.
Unless your driver's bomb
out. Is the Aorus 570. And I really like that copper block on the back.
Oh, that's
I think
nice.
It looks pretty. So I'm just pointing it out.
That is cool.
They say it reduces temperatures. It helps reduce temperatures, which is not true. It doesn't make any difference.
Nice. Well, they can try. Question from, I should have found this earlier. Oh, here we go. Ivan on YouTube. What's the power difference between the 580 and the 480? You know, in long term, sure, you can save a few bucks, but are you making up for it in paying electricity if it's more?
I tested Sapphire's overclocked 580 versus MSI's overclocked 480 Gaming X, and there was only an 11-watt difference there, right? But I know Extreme Tech tested a reference 480 versus an overclocked 580, and it was a 77-watt difference.
Holy smokes.
That's a big difference.
The problem is there's no reference card, so we can't compare apples to apples, right?
I've heard this too, but I'd like to ask you, but is it true that a 580 consumes more power than a 1080 Founders Edition / reference card?
I don't have my chart open in front.
Because
it uses a lot.
It does use a lot of power. But you know, I got to ask this, and I'm going to ask you guys and the internets, why do you even care? Because, I mean, everybody is like, well, how much – I always get this question when I do CPU reviews. How much does that Broadwell E10-core power use? Why do you care? You know, you've got the system. You got, like, two 1080 Ti's. You got, like, four SSDs and three hard drives and two optical drives in there driving your – your 4K 165 hertz panel, and you care how much power the CPU uses or the GPU. Why? Why?
Because you're maximizing everything, right? Come on. You want to be able to brag that it does everything.
Get a laptop, all right? Get a laptop if you want to save power.
Just in saying. A lot of other countries, power's a lot more expensive. I was chatting with somebody on Twitter who was from Spain, and they have insanely high electric bills there. So that alone was enough for them to pick a 1060 over a 480.
Also, then you can skimp on power supplies, Gordon. You know, get a little cheaper power supply.
You can use the included one.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Your cardboard box power supply.
I just think
the U.S., I agree with you.
But how expensive is the power? I don't know. We have an international audience here. Just tell me. I mean, like what? Like, do you, like, they just run out or something? What? It can't be that bad. It can't, I mean.
I don't know, dude. I think it can, actually.
It was roughly half, I think. I don't have my chart in front of me, but it was significantly less power, like over 100 watts less, if I recall correctly, for the 1060 versus the 580. So it's not a little amount if you game a lot and you're in an area where electricity is not cheap, man.
I mean, so these cards, I mean, how much, so like a five, what did your 580 end up using in at the wall, right? So how you measured it?
Yeah, at the wall, whole system.
What were you getting? Like,
I was getting, 1 second, because I happen to be working from afar. I can look at that. I was getting.
It's like under 200 watts, right? 250, I'm guessing, under load?
Under load, 246.
Yeah, so. That's like a light bulb, a 60-watt light bulb. I mean, if you were to, like, look at that, like...
An overclocked EVGA 1060 was 163, so about 80-something watts less.
All right, so 80 watts, which is a light bulb. That's like one light bulb in your house. I mean, is it... I just don't... Is it really that? I mean, how much can they be charging for electricity where you leave a light bulb on for 6 hours or 4 hours, the amount of your gaming is going to make that much of a difference? I just don't... In a desktop application, I don't think it matters.
The 1080 actually used 5 watts less than the 580. But I think a strong selling point for AMD's cards, though, that we haven't talked about, because we've talked about in the past, is FreeSync monitors. Mm-hmm. Because NVIDIA charges a lot for variable refresh rate monitors. And that stuff's amazing. Once you've used it, you can't go back. It's buttery smooth. It's wonderful. And AMD doesn't charge more for it, which I think... adds a lot of value to their mainstream and budget cards, which all of these are. So, sure, they use more energy, but there's other things that they do. And Radeon Chill can help with that if you're using one of those compatible games.
Yeah, nice. I guess I wonder, do you save enough money going with a 480 versus, yeah, I mean, geez. Well, of course, 1080 is a lot more performance than a 580, but...
Yes.
If you're saving $300, you could buy a FreeSync panel. Is it worth $580 with FreeSync versus your non-FreeSync panel?
I was doing some research as far as these articles, and you could find a 75 hertz ViewSonic FreeSync panel for $130. 75 is more than 60.
That's not even...
All these cards, we're talking about 60 frames per second, dude.
I know. I'm just saying. That's 15...
poor audio listeners. I wish they could have seen your face.
Yeah.
15
like, frames. The way you...
15 hertz is like... like a lot of their early G-Sync laptops were 75. It's like, okay, who cares? But, I mean, it does matter because you're still... You're getting less screen tearing, but you're not getting the beauty, buttery, smooth 144 hertz kind of experience either. That to me is, you're sort of giving that up. It's that.
That 144 hertz experience costs a lot more than probably what people who are in the neighborhood for 170 graphics cards.
Yes, that's true. That's true. You're not. No, I am asking a little too much there, aren't I? So, okay. Well,
and to your earlier question for the internet, nobody's saying too much about the power. It's not too big of a difference, but Ivan does have a point that high power usage will increase room temperature, so maybe that's something, you know, if you're a little warm.
Summer gaming is a problem. Yeah. Yeah.
So and then also we're getting some questions about flashing BIOS, but I know we're going to cover that later, right?
Yeah, where you have a question.
Cool. We'll so hold it tight for the BIOS flashing. Yep. We will get to it.
So I guess I'm going to move us on to the next topic. Although we did skip Brad's or any last 500 series questions.
Nope.
Not rebranding on, as Brad says.
Yep.
So
Refreshion.
Refreshion.
Doesn't have the same you know, tune to it, right?
That actually is not bad. See, Refreshion isn't like, yeah, that's not as negative as that Reddit.
It makes me want a nice cool drink on summer day.
I was going to say.
I would say, just because we spend a lot of time discussing back and forth, I would say that bottom line, yes, it's nothing big new over the RX 400 series, but they're still, the 570 and 580 are still the best options in their price point. Doesn't change anything about it. So.
Why NVIDIA just doesn't care, do they? They just don't. I'm really surprised they really haven't gone more aggressively after them. Because the 1060, I know you're not a big fan of the 1063 gig over the 480, and 1050 doesn't cut it either. I mean, sort of, or not enough to make it to wipe them out.
We could go deep down this rabbit hole. There are good points for the 1050 Ti because it doesn't need a power pin connector.
Right. All right.
But yeah, I wouldn't buy a 3 gigabyte card to play 1080p games these days. All but right. Let's move on to Ryzen, because that's a whole other conversation.
That is a whole other conversation. That is, of course, my wheelhouse. Let's Someone explain to me what the wheelhouse is. It's where they sell the wheels.
Yep.
If
the wheels.
You want to know what I think about all that, feel free to check out PC World's Best Graphics Card Hub, by the way, just to plug, you know, help me pay my rent. And
PCWorld.com.
I talk extensively about everything Gordon was just bringing up.
We should have a link to that. Updated this morning. We'll have a link.
Fancy.
We're going to promise a link, which means we will not actually put a link in there. Because whenever somebody says they will do that, they will not do
not
it.
Not doing it.
But we will post a link on the YouTube post, I guess, to the coverage and best what card to buy. And I'm going to move us on to the next one, which, of course, I did all the testing before my vacation, so I can barely remember anything. But it was basically Ryzen 5, which is very different than Ryzen 7, the reception. And I, for the most part, I think everybody was extremely positive. I thought it was an extremely positive part, the Ryzen 5 series. If you don't know, it's basically AMD's 6-core and 4-core parts. Both of them have SMT, you know, slash hyperthreading, if you're not used to SMT as a phrase yet or acronym. And they offer, if I were to sum it up, ass loads of multi-threaded performance, where they just wail on their Intel counterparts for cost. I mean, the Ryzen 5 just absolutely destroys the equivalent Core i5 part in multi-threading, because, damn, you're getting more cores and you're getting SMT slash hyper-threading. For single-threaded tasks, Kaby Lake is slightly faster, you know, 10-15%, because based on IPC and clock speed differences. And in gaming, of course, you know, you get some things that don't run great on Ryzen yet, and you get some things that almost everything is going to run great on Kaby Lake. So there's a minus. Some games doesn't hurt it that bad. Some things you're looking at a 20% deficit on some things and that are not GPU limited. So, but overall, my feeling in this Ryzen 5 is just, it's just, you're getting a 6-core CPU with SMT for $250 MSRP. You know, probably once all the hype dies up, it'll probably be on the street for $230, $240, the equivalent to a Core i5 7600K, which is what I compared it to. And it's just in multi-threading. If you go to, we'll put a link. We're promising a link. We won't do it.
God, damn, come on, Gordon.
On PC World, and it's just like, you look at these. You just like, I'm a big content creator. I love multi-threaded tasks. It just destroys, absolutely destroys the 7600K. So.
Like, how much of, like, how much destruction are we talking here?
City
gone, an entire county, like, state. Like.
Well, there's some things where, yeah, this is a tactical nuclear strike on some things. Like, here, like, Cinebench is a wonderful, heavily multi-threaded benchmark. It scales really, really well with thread count. So, 7600K, we're looking at a score of 691, right? 700. And the Ryzen 5 1600X, basically almost the same price, maybe $10 more on the street these days because Kaby Lake prices have finally come down. It's $1,247. So $691 versus $1,247. I mean, that's like, if you're a content creator, you're like, damn, that's like, you're getting so much more performance out of a Ryzen over.
Well, the i5 parts don't have hyperthreading at all, right? So that's 4 cores, 4 threads, whereas the Ryzen 5 is 6 cores, 12 threads, which is a massive difference for stuff like that.
Yeah. And that's where you just get so much more. And it's actually, it's really interesting because I know when we all did our Ryzen 7 reviews, I know we sort of like half-assed sort of dismissed the Ryzen 5 because it's like, well, at this price point, is it going to be compelling? But I think people forget that, man, those Intel really does limit you with those i5s. They intentionally turn off hyper-threading for marketing reasons because, you know, they got to have something to make you buy the i7. And they turn it off, and man, there's just some things where it just, you get killed in multi-threading tasks. And you'll see, even in gaming, we've seen this where you'll be in a game, something will happen, you know, some physics. This is a classic Battlefield 3 where the buildings start to crumble, and Battlefield 4, the buildings start to crumble. If you're on i5, all four cores are pushed to 100% while that building is crumbling, right? If you're on an i7 with hyper-threading, they're basically, you're at 50%. You can basically have other things running on your computer if you have more than four threads. And of course, I know Brad does not agree with this. You're still one of those i5 non-hyper-threaded gamers, right? Ivy Bridge. So you're 3570K.
Yes, I'm still running that right now.
Right.
But that 1600 is awfully compelling. So
yeah, the 1600.
I mean, I did a couple of build. I did a 1600X build myself, and everything was way past 60 frames per second when I paired it with a 1070, way past 60 frames per second. So people knock on Ryzen, right, about gaming, but right. It holds up just fine. It not be as good as Intel, but it's more than what you could use.
Right. In actual practical use, it's perfectly fine for gaming. So people need to get over that internet meme about it being bad for gaming. But I got to say, people got to admit, KB Lake is faster. Even Broadwell is faster than Ryzen at gaming in general. You could blame it on optimization, whatever it is. But the truth, people got to accept this. We're saying Ryzen's great, great, fine, perfectly fine for gaming. But you want the absolute best, the fastest part, KB Lake for gaming, right? Even Broadwell in some parts. So that's the truth, folks. But for practical,
so that was your bottom line, right?
Yeah. So that's my bottom line. I think there may be a line below that too, but
that basically, like, if you're just gaming, purely single thread gaming, and you're interested in that, still get a i5, right? But if you're looking at it more holistically, if you want to just cross the, you know, what should I buy, and you want a one word answer, it's Ryzen 5. That's what you said, right?
Yeah, I think it's just hard. I mean, God, it's hard to think like, man, I could be having six cores with SMT or this damn i5 where they've cut off the hyper-threading, so I don't get that. You know, although I got to say there are some nice things about KB Lake. The chipset is definitely beefier. Although if you're running a budget chipset, you're not getting as many features. But there's definitely more PCIe lanes in 2 series. Over what you're getting out of a Ryzen part, so and you can get motherboards, right? But
you can get more motherboards these days for Ryzen. They're starting to, you know, that doesn't hurt so much anymore.
The 370 boards are actually kind of available again. Finally.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Yeah.
And well, in this price range, they're pushing. It makes more sense in this price range to get a B350 board too, right? So,
It does. Yeah, for Ryzen.
The big difference with X370 and B350 is there's a couple more PCIe lanes. There's two more PCIe lanes. You can have multiple graphics cards, and there's a couple more USB 3.1, I think, and that's it. Otherwise, I mean, with the B350 boards, which are all around $100, you can overclock your chip. You can, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, have you been hearing any problems on those B350 boards? Grim in YouTube says he got the MSI B350 Gaming Pro motherboard, and it had five in a row be dead on arrival.
Whoa.
So have we heard anything Dang. About that stuff?
No, but clearly there's an issue there, right?
Yeah. So.
I mean,
yeah.
Or you ran into, I mean, you know, maybe, you know, not that I'm into conspiracy theories, but what if Intel is paying your UPS guy to mess your motherboard up before you get it?
Just smash it. I mean, right. The package.
No, but five bad in a row is pretty hard to believe. I'm you That's know probably bad. Just whoever the retailer is clearly had a bad batch, right? So you got all five of them.
Yeah, or
maybe. I've been using Gigabyte boards exclusively because basically that's what AMD sent me. And a lot of people are having stability issues, you know, whatnot, teething issues with the first round of motherboards. But the Gigabyte boards that I've tried have all been great. I had one issue with an NVMe SSD with the B350, the Gaming 3, but I cleared that up in an hour. and I haven't had an issue since.
Yeah.
So if I was going to, like, when people ask me what board should I buy, at this point I tell them, try to get the Gigabytes because they're a lot more stable.
Well, and he said he switched to ASRock, Killer SLI AC, and yeah, he said it's working fine, so.
Yeah, and I think most of my testing was on a MSI Tomahawk B350 board, so. And I didn't have issues, but, you know, clearly, you know, it was a pre-vetted board. They're not going to send me a board to test.
So. Not five in a row, either.
Oh, five in a row is not pretty. Although, I mean, five in a row. Not that I wouldn't insult you, but is it, maybe he had a bad, I mean, did it, where really was the board? Because I have gotten many, many letters in over the years from people saying all these issues. It's like, man, you just like... Like, do you have, like, really dirty electricity or something like that? Or is your...
Turns out half the pins are bent on the processor.
Yeah. They cheap out on the power supply, Gordon. There we go. They got a non-modular power supply. You know.
I think a really cool part of the Ryzen 5 story to me is, yeah, which sounds lame, like marketing, whatever, is that they all overclock, even on these cheap B350 boards.
Yeah.
Because, like, if you buy a B350 board, which is roughly $100, and we reviewed the 1600X, but people who buy the 1600, which is $30 or $40 cheaper.
And comes with a heatsink.
And it comes with a heatsink. And you overclock that, then that's an awful lot of value right there.
And actually, that's one thing that reminds me I want to bring up. I love that you're getting, you know, unlocked parts. I kind of wish Intel would do it, but I can tell you why Intel doesn't do it, because they want you to pay more for the K parts, and everybody's been conditioned to buy K parts, even though they're never going to overclock the damn things, right? I got to wonder if it's a mistake for AMD not to lock. Now, I know you're going to hate me for saying this, but should those non-X parts, they should have been locked in some ways. Because, like, why would you buy an X part? Like, I might as well
to
just
guarantee that overclock, right? Because these basically go up to the speeds of the 1600X or whatever. Like the 1600, it was the same with the 1700. They'll go up to the top rated speeds of the X chips, but it's not guaranteed whatsoever.
No.
Whereas with these X chips, it's okay, here's where it is.
Yeah, but you're not, and we're not looking at, like, oh my God, my 1600X, I'm hitting a 4.8 overclock, right? So you're looking at, I'm getting, you know, 4.1 maybe pushing if I'm lucky, where I might get 3.9 or so. It's not, to me, it's not like you're just getting a ton more overclocking headroom, you know, so.
I think it's cool. I like it because, like you say, a lot of people don't overclock.
Right.
And those people will buy the faster chips. I think it's a cool bone to toss at enthusiasts who are buying into AMD's platform, right?
Right. But, I mean, like, if you were an AMD investor, you'd go, like, God, these things should be locked, you know?
Yeah, but honestly, if you're coming back into, like, the scene after a long period of not really being, like, super competitive, then you have to have something to make you seem appealing. You can't play by the same rule book as the dominating party anymore.
Right.
So. Yep.
And AMD's done this for a long time, right? Because, I mean, God, every AMD part for the last 4 or 5 years feels like it's been unlocked almost. So,
yep. The interesting part about this conversation, just to delve into rumor territory,
uh-oh,
is that the rumors out now say that part of Intel's response will be the i5 series will be hyper-threading, and they might add 6 cores to the i7 series for the next one, which, you know, who knows if that's true, but that's the rumors floating around the internet right now.
Yeah, and there's rumors of X299 up to 12 cores now, which before I think it was up to 10 cores. So they're saying, rumors say, you know, Skylake X, Kaby Lake X, up to 10 to 12 cores, X299 at Computex, right? I mean, that's what who knows if it's
which
true.
You will be attending, right?
I will be attending
live from the show.
I'm sure it will just now ruin my summer. So, yeah, and I think I saw that in Guru 3D this morning, right?
It's been a few places.
Yeah.
So we got a question from Pablo on YouTube.
Hi, Pablo.
Hey. He's asking about, what about Ryzen and ECC memory? Can you talk about that?
It supports
that?
It.
Yeah, ECC is supported.
The question is whether your memory, whether your motherboard supports it.
Yeah, is that it? I don't know why. I guess you could run ECC to get higher density for the most part. I'm not really a big believer in ECC. You know, for people who don't know, it's error correction code, and they're able to detect single bit errors, and multi bit errors can be detected. It'll let you know. Usually ECC is run on servers. There's an extra chip for the parity check. You can get larger DIMMs, And most of them also are a lot slower too, so lower clock speeds. So Ryzen very much to get the best performance out of it. You need to be that RAM needs to be pushed like very, very high speeds. So I'm not sure if I care about ECC on Ryzen unless we're talking about, you know, these 12 core parts where you might be running 128 gigs or 256 gigs of RAM, then you know, ECC would be nice.
I would expect to see more ECC like push if a high-end processor line does come out, right? If they introduce like a Extreme Edition competitor.
Yeah, but you know, the funny thing there is it used to be you could get ECC support on lower end Intel parts, you know, i7, but then they were like, you know what, that's a Xeon feature. You want ECC, you gotta go Xeon. You're not going to get that on a Toy i7.
That's another thing. Ryzen, all the chip support.
They get AMD 100%
on the
right?
motherboard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I'm not 100% sure you're going to want to do your research, but I believe I've read that ASRock motherboards support ECC memory.
Yeah.
So look in that direction.
I can't imagine it being too much. It's most because the memory control is in the chip, so it can't be too hard to. Maybe they just did the enable BIOS support for it. And then, you know, clearly, you know, you want to talk about Ryzen teething pains. Memory has been, you know, kind of a little wacky touch on Ryzen, right? Like,
yeah.
On the original Ryzen 7s, you can't run 4 DIMMs beyond, you know, JEDEC speed. So you're looking at 2133 with all the DIMM slots full. I don't know if that's improved with latest BIOSes, but
it's touchy enough that people who are looking to push it as far as they need to are looking specifically for memory made with Samsung B dies on one side of the module.
Samsung
kind of deal.
They're not looking, and I, you know, this whole like, oh, do you need you need dual rank versus single rank? And like, oh, yeah. Oh man, you know, it's like that's a lot of brain power to burn on selecting memory. So.
But a lot of them, I mean, I'm having a good deal with Corsair Vengeance. I mean, I've had no problem getting those working. And it's 4/21 right now, April 21st. And in early May, AMD said that they're going to have another big BIOS update or a GISA, whatever they call it, that trickles down into BIOSes that fixes memory stability and increases speeds there. So
yeah, in fact,
hopefully that's fixed soon.
Yeah, and the B350 board that I did do all my Ryzen 5 testing features, that BIOS, I believe, that is going to be rolling out to other vendors as they, because the board I have supposedly can hit 3200. I did all my testing for Ryzen 7. I did it at JEDEC speeds, mostly because I like to run full DIMM loads. I did that in all the boxes, Bridwell and Kaby Lake and FX. For Ryzen 5, I actually recalibrated because clearly you need higher speed memory. I ran everything at 2933. No problems running 2933 on the Tomahawk board. And apparently the BIOS I have will run it at 3200 if I want to. So, but I mean, you know, but you know, again, like, see, there was a line below the bottom line, Brad. Bottom line is, damn, it's really hard to say no to a Ryzen 5. Yeah, if you only play games and you're not going to be streaming to Twitch or whatever, where you're going to be using those other CPU threads to do your encoding, Kaby Lake's fine. Perfectly great. Platform stable. It's all there. It's all known. You know, not going to have any problems with it. Great chip. But, you know, if you're going to do any kind of multi-threading, it's like, damn, how do you say no to all that? I mean, it's really hard to say buy i5-7600K, for me anyway.
I was testing. I did a quick build, and I did some quick tests with the 1500X, too, which we haven't had a chance to fully review yet.
Right.
And even that paired with a 480, not a 580, it was pushing games past 60 frames per second, smooth as hell, no problem. Right. So,
and
that's $190, I think.
Yeah. Would you? I mean, and for people who don't know that 1500X is a quad core with SMT on, so it's their equivalent as far as thread count of a 7700K i7. Who's that?
Sorry,
T-Mobile.
Sorry, that was me.
Well, that's a T-Mobile sound. I thought you said you're Verizon.
I'm Verizon. Sorry, I'm testing this phone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've got
like,
the S8 here.
For that?
Sorry,
just
I'm sorry.
Like,
yeah.
Have the little.
By the
discreet.
Way, Ryzen 5 brought to you by T-Mobile. Just kidding.
And Samsung S8.
Yeah.
You're slyly trying to get a reference there to
no,
Samsung S8.
Sorry. No. Nope.
Yeah. Which, by the way, I'm going to point out that fingerprint radar. I just got to say this.
Why did they put it there?
Because
no,
the alien ET he's got to have a phone too, okay? Now, when E.T.'s sticking that phone out, if the fingerprint reader is down, he's always curving his finger. Now, for the S8 E.T., that finger can make it all the way up. That S8 is designed for E.T.
No, Gordon, we know the reason they didn't move it, because then you would have to move the Samsung logo. You know, that's the real reason.
Yeah. No, it's for E.T. That's a 1980s reference. All right. So that's it. Ryzen 5, awesomeness.
Man, we got people chomping awesome, at the bit awesome for 1080 Ti. Please,
Look at that.
Give
see,
people
the topic
what they
we
want.
Make last is the one that
they want. 1080 Ti.
See, we look, we do segment AMD, right? Yeah. Red, all red. And then we go more AMD, all red. And then now, of course, everybody wants NVIDIA stuff. And then.
Well, isn't AMD green on the computer side, on the CPU side?
Yeah, that is rather confusing. Are they still? They used. I don't know. I still have cards from AMD where the logo has green on it. So I know the AMD Sunnyvale logo is green. I don't really know what their corporate color is anymore.
Are they now orange? I guess Ryzen's orange, right? Gray? Team gray?
I don't know. I mean, it's really easy when they sort of have these sort of like gang affiliation colors, right?
Blue!
Intel blue, right? And then they did Intel orange for a while with Pentium 4. All right. Let's get on it. Everybody, all right. So
give the people what they want.
Give the people. Yeah. So we're gonna move on to. Oh, there it goes. Damn.
So that
is. So Brad is gonna tell you what that is.
This is the first custom GTX 1080 Ti that we've tested. EVGA's GTX 1080 Ti SC2, which
spin it around a little bit.
I believe launching on Monday and is available for pre-order right now. For $720, which is only $20 more than the Founders Edition.
Wow.
Nice.
So, and I had people on Twitter mad at me because I didn't show the back of it.
You got to show all around, man.
So, there's the back of it. Let's cover that serial number, I guess.
People are like, it's just so like the back plate. Why do the people care about the back plate? I don't know.
People are so excited that we've moved on.
That's the part you see when you're looking in through your window, right? You don't see that part.
Is that can you hold it up again? So the front, is that aluminum? Like the whole shell is aluminum there, or is it plastic?
Yep.
Oh, nice.
That's all metal.
Some form of metal.
And then you can see through it, and you can see the big beefy heatsink underneath.
Does it have the LEDs?
Yes, it has LEDs. The side lights up in LEDs. This uses EVGA's ICX cooling technology, which came out earlier this year. I tested it then. I really liked it then. It's really come into its own with this card. It basically, after EVGA had a big issue last year where some For the Winds were overheating, they introduced a new cooling technology that has 9 temperature sensors inside of this card and any card with ICX. And basically, it keeps track of those and... It keeps track of your GPU temperature for one, and that drives the speed of the right-hand fan. And it keeps track of your PWMs and memory temperatures as well with these other sensors, and those drive the speed of the left fan independently. So each fan is dynamically adjusting to keep specific components cool inside your card. And it works really, really freaking well in this.
Is it quieter than a reference 1080 Ti?
Oh, way quieter. Like, not even, like, night and day difference. But the cool thing about it is you can't see it here because it's not lit up. But right here, right above the 1080 on the side of the thing, there are 3 different lights, G, P, and M. And they'll change color depending on how hot those different components are. So there's the G is for the GPU, the P is for the PWMs, the M is for the memory. This card stayed so cool. I was trying everything I could to take a picture with those lighting up red so I could show that off. And I couldn't push it that hard.
Really?
I mean, I could not get it. I mean, if I wanted to do something drastic, I probably could, but no reasonable scenario could I push it that hard.
The card stayed. Just tape the fans up.
He said reasonable, Gordon.
You know what? That is a simulation of... somebody's modular power supply getting stuck in the fan of the GPU. That's totally reasonable.
Modular power supplies wouldn't get stuck. You mean non-modular power supplies?
There you
well,
go.
You have to store.
There you go.
You got to store your extra modular power supply somewhere, so they would get jammed in there.
Backstory here is Gordon likes modular power supplies. Non-modular power supplies because he's nuts.
Yeah, we're gonna have a writing question about that. But we got a lot of people asking about the difference between SC2 and FTW3 and all that sort of fun stuff.
Sure. So this is the SC2. This has the big difference between the two is that the SC2 has 7+2 power phases inside. It has an 8-pin and a 6-pin connector, and it only has a single BIOS. Whereas the FTW3, which I don't think they've publicly announced a date for that yet, it's not available yet, that has dual BIOSes, which helps for overclocking. It has, I believe, 10+2 phase inside, which also helps with energy efficiency for overclocking. It has an 8 and 8-pin power connector, so you can feed it more juice. And it has slightly higher out-of-the-box clock speeds. So basically, the FTW3 is this card, but with more overclocking features.
Nice.
Wow.
So, and the interesting thing about this, the temperatures, by the way, on this card, with the default quiet fan curve that EVGA enables, the hottest I could get it was 67 degrees Celsius, the GPU. And I was keeping track of the other things using EVGA's Precision X software, which you have to use in order to use all these fancy ICX cooling things. And all the other, the memory modules and the PWMs were even cooler than that. So, and then they have an aggressive fan curve that I enabled while I was just hastily doing some overclocks. And even overclocked, it was keeping the GPU under 60 degrees with the aggressive fan curves. So.
Wow. Do you have to register to download Precision X still?
I get special reviewer copies, so I'm not sure.
Freddie is asking, what about the SC Black? Is it even worth getting?
SC Black, I don't know the specs for that off the top of my head. So, unfortunately, I can't answer that.
How much faster is that card over a Founders Edition slash reference card? Yeah.
It depends. In a couple of games, like Hitman and something else, it was only about 3% faster. In some other games, it was 6.5 to 10% faster. It averaged out to 5.7% faster. When I did a real quick and dirty overclock on it, didn't touch the power limits, just cranked it up as much as I could, basically, on the GPU core clock, that more than doubled. So it gets pretty fast. It's fast enough that this is the first graphics card to ever push a bottleneck in one of our games off of the GPU and onto the CPU. It got bottlenecked at 1440p in Ashes of the Singularity.
Nice.
That was really interesting. I'm going to be upgrading the system soon for everybody watching that. So soon we'll be, our GPU test system will have different hardware inside of it. So that doesn't happen again. But that's how fast an overclocked Founders Edition card is that we saw our first ever bottleneck.
Actually, we did get a question about what CPU you tested it with.
That was with the 5960X. So that's the 8-core
Haswell E
part. It's not clocked terribly high. I think it's 3 or 3.5 gigahertz. So I think for the next system, we're going to have a 7700K. 7700K.
Yeah, it's 7700K steps it up quite a bit over Haswell E too. So, but yeah, I guess, but you could overclock it a bit if you wanted to on that Haswell E.
Yeah, but I mean, the important part is this is the, every other game that we've ever tested, I've never seen that happen. This is the first card that was fast enough to make that happen. So
for $729, damn.
So it's nice. Only $20 more.
$720. It is. There's still some debate. They haven't gotten back to me with the final amount. Right now, it's a pre-order price of $720.
Okay.
They're not sure what the final price is going to be. It might be $750. Might be $720 still. With either of those numbers, I think it's a worthwhile buy. If it's $720, it's a damned worthwhile buy. So.
So, in other words, if you really want this, pre-order now.
Yeah, get it now. Get about it. Get it.
Get it now. Buy it now.
We got a couple people asking about how do you think this would pair with a Ryzen 1600X?
Great. Because the issue with the Ryzen 1600X, the whole controversy over Ryzen gaming is that it's a little bit slower than Intel parts in some games, right? So if you throw a crazy graphics card at it, that doesn't matter because the whole bottleneck goes on the GPU instead. So,
yeah, I mean, you would give up some performance. 4K. Yeah. So where does the 1080 where does that card, we're talking, that is a 4K Ultra, pretty much 60 frames per second.
Roughly? Oh yeah. Okay. Yep. This was enough with the Founders Edition. A couple of games, 4K Ultra. Let me think. Far Cry Primal and The Division didn't quite hit 60 frames per second. This does out of the box. And if you do a quick and dirty overclock, like I said, I didn't touch the power. I barely touched the memory. I just cranked the core clock just a little bit. Took me 5 minutes, and it more than doubled the performance increase. So
nice.
It got up to, with that quick and dirty overclock, this thing was a little bit over 10% faster, 11% faster than the Founders Edition. So,
wow.
And much, much quieter and cooler.
Yeah, noise is nice. I mean, because those Founders Edition cards, it's a good design, but those fans, once they heat up, man, they just...
Also, I really don't like how they blow out the back.
But that's a plus. I gotta say,
depends what you're using it for.
Yeah.
If you're running it, I think in a great big desktop, it's fine because you've got other fans exhausting the heat. But again, you look at, like, behind me, there's a Falcon Northwest box with two 1080 Ti's. I know, Falcon has told me they like the rear exhaust because it sucks all the hot air out of smaller machines and blows it out. Mm-hmm. So that's a positive. Whereas that just kind of circulates in the machine.
The only negative, pseudo-negative I had for this, aside from, not many people will be able to afford it. If you can afford it, the only pseudo-negative I have is the design of the shroud, which I actually really like. You might not be able to see it on here, but it has sparkles too, so it looks like a gravel road almost. It sparkles when the light hits it. But I've seen on forums some people say they hate the look of it. I've seen other people say they love the look of it. So that's the only negative I have, whether or not the shroud design's for you.
Oh man, you're picking some pretty big battles there.
So today on the show I have said that this $80 graphics card is too expensive, and this $720 graphics card is a steal.
It's
in case
cheap.
Anybody's keeping score at home.
It's all context, right?
It's all about the value you get at that price.
Yeah.
Yep. So is your review out now?
Yes, it went live today. We're actually, I believe, the first review on the internet.
And where can we find that review, Brad?
Oh, are we getting another link?
PCWorld.com.
PCWorld.com, if you're going there on April 21st.
And we will not link to it.
We will promise to put a link to it, and we will not ask to link to it. So you'll have to search for it somewhere.
Yeah. We have a question from Daniel. Where is the 3D memory HBM Pascal chip that they promised at GDC 2014? Where is it?
I thought that was only in the compute card. They do have it though, right?
Yeah, they have the HBM2 you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's I forget what they call it. The big high-end one that just went on sale. They're one that you can buy at universities or something like that.
yeah you have,
it's when there.
You buy it, you sit down, and they have the guy from finance talk to you about it. We do this over 4 years.
They actually announced that before they even announced the 10 series, but it only just now started being sold in the past few weeks.
The sample the availability of HBM2 is not looking pretty, but we'll see, right?
Nope.
What was I going to ask? And of course, you can run that in SLI, just two way. I asked just so I can make Brad angry because he doesn't believe
you could.
SLI.
But I mean, if it's not worth buying two cards and a $200 card, imagine how bad you would feel if you got two $720 cards and one of them didn't run in half the games that you played.
Now, yeah, I was gonna, but and then of course I'm very conscious about the power my big ass desktop gaming system is using too. So why would I run?
It's about
two,
the
right?
same as a Fury X.
Wow, really?
God, yeah. That's,
I can't imagine. And the Fury X is a pretty dated card at this point. So it's
this takes a lot of power. Something this powerful takes a lot of energy, but the Fury X is. I didn't even bother testing it alongside this at this point. It's a little bit less than the 1070, so.
We got another question from Ruru2. Is it a two-slot card or is it 2.5?
That's the important question because this is a two-slot card.
Oh.
And pretty much every other custom GTX 1080 Ti that I've seen so far has either been 2.5 or 3 slots.
Three, wow.
So they're really big to, you know, keep this GPU cool. But this one manages to do that while fitting in. It's kind of thick 2-slot card, but it's still a 2-slot card.
Nice.
Wow. God, I'm just trying to think of the last time I've seen a 3-slot card.
It's huge.
It's been a while.
I don't know if I've ever seen one.
Go shopping for GTX 1080 Ti's, man.
Oh.
They are thick.
Titan Z was technically a 3-slot card because the back plate was for 3. So for
I think
support.
the Zotac Amp Extreme, I believe, is a 3-slot card. I think that their higher-end one is. But does it really matter to a lot of people if you only have this and a... you know, in a standard mid-tower case, and this is the only thing you got plugged into your motherboard. I think this probably isn't going to make that much of a difference, but it's still impressive to see them be able to do this with a 2-slot card, whereas all the other ones are 2.5 and 3-slot.
I guess that is a testament to the cooling that EVGA has put into that card, right?
Yeah.
If they can really cool it and get the clocks out of it that other people are running 2.5 or 3 wide, that's not bad.
Mm-hmm. Alejandro is asking, does Vega have a chance with all the high-end craze going towards the 1080 Ti?
Sure, it depends what it does. Nobody has any idea yet.
Yeah, we don't know.
Have
right?
to be that guy. But that's my answer. We have no idea, right? We have no idea. It'll have HBM2, which will be fast, which will be awesome. Who knows what it'll actually do. They've only shown a few demos. They haven't said whether that was the high-end card, the low-end card, the only card. There's at this point, you can't really guess. So.
Yeah, but it does seem tough because, I mean, Vega's not here, right? And it doesn't, you know, if you're AMD faithful, it's tough. But it's hard to see Vega coming out and being a 1080 Ti slayer. I mean, it doesn't seem like it. But yeah, again, Brad is right.
Yeah,
we don't know. It could be, right? Yeah, I mean, for all we know, they've been sandbagging it just to try to get one over. And it does happen sometimes where companies kind of sandbag stuff. There are leaks that are really bad that it's hard to keep secrets, but you know, sometimes they can. AMD's actually been really good about keeping secrets too lately. So mm-hmm. We don't know.
Yeah. Well, look, like I've brought this up a few times before. Last time they were showing off the Vega performance or Fury performance quite a bit, right? Tease and stuff. And then 2 weeks before that, NVIDIA put out a card, the 980 Ti, at a damned affordable price to that kind of set the upper limit of what it could be because it matched the 980 Ti exactly. So if they do have a powerful card, I wouldn't be surprised if they were keeping quiet about it so that a repeat of that doesn't happen.
Yeah. And I got to say, that's why I was surprised with the 500 series because I thought AMD was launching 500 because NVIDIA was going to come out with some new, you know, budgety, you know, 1060 1050 class card that
they still might. Knows.
Yeah.
We got a good question from 6Taku9. Does the 1080 Ti mean or indicate the end of SLI?
I think it's been dying for years, personally. That's why Gordon looked over at the TV, because I have that strong opinion. Games just aren't supporting it as much. I think it'll still be around. I think I wouldn't expect NVIDIA to change what it's doing now, which is to support dual cards, right? And AMD supports all kinds of Crossfire things. It's dying, though. I mean, a lot of games that come out don't support multiple cards. And if they do, it's usually weeks or months after launch. So it's kind of a crapshoot right now, as is.
Yeah, and I disagree because I do think, and I'm not going to say specifically SLI or Crossfire, but I think multi-GPU configurations will be back. Right now, it's definitely in a hibernation mode. A lot of that is game support, as Brad says, but you know, I think NVIDIA and AMD have also seen, like, you know what, DX12 is going to make it so that we'll solve it with the API. Eventually, you'll get, you know, support for multi-cards through DX12. But of course, that support will come once we actually get DX12 games that actually will use all of the CPU cores that DX12. So we're talking at least 24 months away, it feels like.
Somebody was arguing with me about that the other day, because I forget the context. But they were arguing with me that, yeah, DX12 does SLI or Crossfire now. But what DX12 does is that puts that burden on the developer rather than on NVIDIA and AMD. And we have seen very, 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 very few, like 2 or 3, I think, DirectX 12 games that support multiple GPUs. Because right. the developer is not going to do that, put all that work in for something that's such a headache when so few people run multiple graphics cards. So people are looking at DX12 as a savior, and I think that might actually be the death knell of it.
I don't know, but I mean, if you move it to DX12 and again, things are not static. We get the DX13, maybe this is a solution that, you know, can be baked in through the API where, like, hey, you just get more performance. It's just more compute units, more cores. There's no reason to just simply give you more, right? And I don't think NVIDIA and AMD want to give it up because they like money. Selling people. Yeah. Hey, you're going to buy one 1080 Ti. Isn't it better to sell you four 1080 Ti's? I mean, that's a hell of a business. So it's going to happen again one day. But right now, yeah, it is a really tough sell.
You can run four Ti's and four-way SLI right now if you want, but NVIDIA only supports it in benchmarking programs.
Yeah. Well, there's some older games that still support it too, so... But yeah, it's a tough sell to recommend. And Brad, I just recently found in our garage a GTX 590. So that was a dual 570 card. It's like, oh hey,
nice.
I should bring in my collection of dual cards.
And we should.
Yeah.
Memory lane.
We got a question. Some people are asking about the power requirements for the 1080 Ti. What do you think is a safe power supply?
It's 250 watts, I believe, is the TDP. I think it's a 500 watt power supply is the minimum, if I'm remembering correctly. It might be these days, if you're using a modern CPU and a modern graphics card, as in released in the past year or two, kind of a deal. I think that you don't need more than 650 watts unless you're going to go multi graphics card, which you shouldn't do, like we just talked about.
Yeah. Well, yeah, definitely. I think, yeah, 650 is sort of like that floor, I think. I mean, so my argument, I always like to oversize power supplies. So I'd rather have extra because... go ahead.
Also, the money you're saving by not going modular,
yes.
You can get a bigger amount of power. So it's perfect. It works out.
Yeah, I mean, they charge you more for the modular power supply, man. If you buy the non-power supply one, you get non-modular,
Power supply, power supply.
But so my argument for why I always now, if you're Dell, if you're HP, Alienware, whatever, you've got engineers, they can say, we can run this on 500 watts. And you go, it's like, how's that possible? Right? Some of these things, like, it seems like they are just the absolute bare minimum. And that's because they have actual engineers going, you're going to put this hardware, here's what you can hit, it'll be fine. We have this, we know this, you know, we have quality power supplies made by, you know, like Delta, right? So it's a good power supply. They know what you can do. You know, for me, average person, you go like, I don't know what I'm going to put in the machine. I also don't know the temperature. And remember, power supplies, as the room gets hotter, the efficiency goes down. So 650 is great in the winter. 650 with a Ti overclock, with an overclock CPU and all the other crap you're running on it, you may have issues. So I always like having extra. So
well, the thing with power supplies is you want to try to hit like that 40 to 60% usage range for the peak efficiency. I was using a 650 watt power supply testing this, I believe, like I said, and my whole system power draw, which again is not using an overclocked processor, it was using the overclocked EVGA card. The max that I saw was 313 watts for the entire system power. So that's right in there at that 50% for 650 watts. So
yeah, except, you know, once we get to summer, but you know, I just think I like having a bigger power supply. So that's my recommendation for safety. But yeah, we don't live in the days where you need a 1500 or 1600 watt power supply anymore. Those days are kind of gone. So it's like a big block V8 almost.
Sorry, Gordon, another question from JamFewTube asking, have you seen any real DX12 games or are they all DX11 conversions?
Ashes. Right, Ashes of Singularity is of course the premier DX12 demo. I mean, it's
the Microsoft games because they're built 100% for DirectX 12 to run on Xbox and to run on Windows 10. Gears of War and Forza are both great, man.
Well,
audio listeners cannot see Gordon's face right now, but it's pretty precious.
Does it really?
Those
games
run great and they look great.
Yeah, I mean, but like to me, 80% of the excitement of DXO was like, you got 8 cores, all these, you know, you've got SMT, you get all this more. We ain't getting no more out of these. Does Forza give you more if you have an 8 core 16 thread part? Probably not.
I have not tested it.
Yeah, I'm gonna say survey says no, probably, because I tried Gears, you didn't get anything out of that game. So I think the DX12 dream, I still think, I disagree, 24 months from now. It'll be a different world 24 months. Game development's a long cycle, so.
I think there's always going to be, we might see some more DirectX 12 exclusive built for DirectX 12 eventually, but I think in PC gaming, DirectX 11 and DirectX 12 are going to live next to each other for a long time.
Yeah.
Because DirectX 11 makes it easy, and so many people still have Windows 7. So.
Sure. I mean, DX 11 will be around for a long time. But game developers, especially on the PC, unlike the console, like to do showcase technology things where they do awesome stuff. Like, you know, we're going to do one better than you, so we're going to do this or do that. So it'll happen on the PC really quickly, I think. It'll just be like a... Like they turn the key. All right. Maybe we should get to the last segment.
Yes,
like,
we should.
Oh my God.
We should.
We are going to get, somebody's going to come through that door and yell.
That's
at
what
us.
Happens like when we Kool-Aid wait so long man. Between episodes.
Yeah, right.
I know. It's been a while, right? A couple weeks.
All right.
Should we get to the questions?
Yeah, let's do it. We got some questions.
And I'm going to apologize for everybody because, I get so much spam at the mailbox. It thought like, oh, nobody's ever emailing us. We actually have a lot of emails. So I'm going to give some shout outs. I feel bad too.
Some of these are really old.
This is from Kevay. And the other reason we shouldn't actually use names is because we're going to mangle them. Kevay Bamez. God dang it. This is like that Sean Spicer imitation. Melissa McCarthy does it. All right. Kevay. Great job on the podcast. Please keep them coming. Thanks, everybody. Question is, there's some buzz around HP Elite X3 phone coming out, which will supposedly replace your laptop. Unfortunately, phones such as this one won't run x86 apps and would be stuck with one would be stuck with Windows 10 apps from the App Store. Do you think we will ever see pocket PCs similar to the Elite X3, but with Intel chips? If so, when? Is that a conflict with Microsoft's interest, and will they pursue virtualization and subscription services? Clearly, this question is from the past. We've used our time machine. I'll quickly answer it. No, hell no. Intel's given up on phones. That all has been blown up. We will never see it. Microsoft is interested. In fact, they have done emulation of some sort with that new ARM chip from Qualcomm to actually run native, you know, Windows applications, desktop apps, but they're not actually x86. They're x86 emulated, right, I think? Mm-hmm. That demo they did, so
yeah,
they're interested in it. To me, it doesn't make any sense. I say just go out and get a tablet x86.
The Galaxy S8 that just came out has its little deck stock.
Oh, you mean
and,
this
work
guy
with
right
Microsoft
here?
To get Office apps working on it.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I don't think that dream is, the Surface Phone is probably never going to happen in a reasonable way that anybody will care about. So, because Intel's given up, and you know, where else are you going to get x86 and emulation? As much as it looks cool, I can't believe it's ever going
to. Microsoft's given up too. Nobody wants to do it.
Yeah,
yeah. Just God, $9 billion. Think if Microsoft had taken like $500 million of that $9 billion they blew on Nokia. To like put into DX12, for God's sake. We'd be having like, you know, 6-way SLI crossfire and like 24-core CPUs.
I just wanted a Nokia Android phone, man. That's all I wanted.
All right. This is from Alexis Rodriguez. In regards to shortage of... okay, this is... All right. Blah, blah, blah. All right. I'm really wrong. Holy smokes. I'm sorry. I'm going to give you a shout out because you sent the email. I didn't read it. Send us another one. I will read it next time, Alexis Rodriguez. I know that sucks, doesn't it?
Such great.
Gordon's the crusher of dreams.
Just such great fan acknowledgement here, right?
Larry Froling. Oh. Building a new HTPC in one ITX form factor. Found a case that will take a full length GPU. Usage will mainly be movies, but moderate gaming as well, and am interested in VR as well. One, what GPU should I consider? I only game moderately 1080p, but do want 4K playback possibility and potential VR in the future. Two, is there a slimline optical drive that will support 4K HDR movies? I can answer two. Brad can answer one.
Okay,
you Elena go first. Will tell you console. Scorpio.
Xbox One. Man,
I don't, so I mean. I don't even see where that's coming from.
I don't know. I'm just trying
to... I mean, so the answer to number two is...
I'm just trolling.
No. That's slim.
I got There's only one 4K HDR Blu-ray player you can even buy, an optical drive for PCs right now, right?
Actually, they're just starting to come out. This, and I will say, in CyberLink Media has their... HDR 4K. Now, I'm going to say this so that it's fair. So you can run 4K HDR on a PC now, but the checklist is a little longer than what it takes to take off in the space shuttle. You basically need a specific Intel motherboard with HDMI 2.0a and Intel SXT support. You need a KB Lake processor only, will not work on Skylake. In fact, I think you need a certain level of KB Lake processor to work. And, of course, you then need CyberLink media player. And you need a certain, there's a full height desktop optical drive, and there actually is, I don't think it's quite slimline, but it actually did look like it was a slimline because it was in a portable USB. Once you do all that, you can then play... an HDR movie, which I think you could do on a $100 console.
I mean, you can still just rip your videos in and not worry about that copy protection, right? If you already own the DVD or whatever.
Yeah, but you want HDR. HDR right now the content protection is pretty insane. So really, I'm gonna do it as a build. I want to build an HDR 4K capable PC, but. Yeah, I would probably say go out and get a Samsung or an Xbox, whatever. Doesn't the new Xbox play
Xbox
HDR?
Xbox One S.
Yeah, the One S. I mean, does it do the HDR?
No, I think both do.
See, I can... Yeah.
Yeah.
No, wait. Both do?
No, the PlayStation not does not do 4K. Well, it does, not it does 4K, and it does HDR, but it doesn't do 4K movies.
Yeah.
No, I mean, both versions of the Xbox One. I thought that they patched that in.
The original Xbox One does not support it. No.
Oh, and actually, sorry, that's Scott Johnston that sent that.
As far as the graphics card go, I was going to go ahead and recommend a 1050, a GTX 1050 or 1050 Ti, until you got to the part about VR readiness. If you want to play VR, you're going to need a 480 or a 1060 at the minimum. Depending how thick your case is, you might want to look more closely because, like we were talking about earlier, the 1060 uses a lot less power, generates a lot less heat than the 480. So if you're using a slim home theater PC case, you might want to go in that direction rather than the 580.
Okay. Now this one is from Larry. Two questions.
Are you sure?
He says, yeah, because I have no idea. Hi, nerds. Two questions. I've been thinking about replacing my 2010 box rig. I was wondering if you might think it worthwhile to wait for the Zen release with a hopeful competition. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
These are old, huh?
Yeah, they are a little old, clearly. Also, new build would be more for training that would use VM. Yeah, I may run 4 to 5 virtual machines with a web browsing, 16 gigs. Yeah. I would say 1700, kind of like that would be my preference. What do you guys think for running all those virtual machines? Definitely over a KB Lake part because you're not getting.
Yeah, you want more cores, right?
You want more cores for all those VMs.
More cores, as much RAM as you can throw at it, so you can dedicate more RAM to them.
Yeah, yeah.
So the Ryzen 700 series really seems like a sweet spot, unless you're looking to keep it cheap. And then I would say, the 1600 still gives you 6 cores for 210.
Yeah. Definitely. But 1700, great buy. Okay, I'm going to keep moving here because we got to go.
hurry.
Oscar and you. Hello, friends. Looking at these videos, what laptop does Gordon use? Probably when you were watching this, I was using the Pixel Chromebook. This that everybody says is a Mac. Look, man, HP. Can you do this on your Mac? No, HP.
So. You wouldn't bring it back again.
Yeah. And you can. You could take. People don't know this. If you have a MacBook Air, there's a mode. Apple doesn't tell you about it. You can take it. It'll go all the way back to about here. I know it's going to, it just stops. But if you keep pushing on that MacBook Air, it will do that.
Don't. The lawyers and then you will break it. Right now,
yes. Don't do that. That's just a joke. I'm just trolling you. Wait. Okay. Sorry.
At first, I was like, "Oh, I'm about to learn something."
No, come on. I used a MacBook Air at my last job. I already knew that he was going to troll. Well, also, it's Gordon. So
come on, I'm just having fun here, guys. I broke my MacBook Air.
It's fun for you. Not so much for the person who actually tries it.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sai's got a question.
All right, Sai has a question. Knudsen, Lotto Family, Leroy says, "Hey, good show. Love it." From Toronto, Canada. We know. A boot. Right? Hi, I play a lot of Battlefield 1 multiplayer, and I would like to know if upgrading to an 8-core CPU would actually improve gameplay / frames per second for that game. I currently have a Z87 Haswell 4770K overclocked to 4.3, 16 gigs of 1600 DDR3. GTX 1080 SLI, Brad, and 950 Pro, and a 1440p 144 hertz panel. That's a nice setup, man. Mm-hmm. Robert Scott wrote that.
Battlefield 1 loves threads. So, I mean, if you toss threads at it, it will get better, but I don't think that an upgrade would be very cost efficient with what you've already got going. That's a good setup. And that's a 4770, you said, or something like
4770K.
That?
4770K.
So that's already 8 threads, so...
Yeah, a nice box. I don't know what you would do to improve that. That's maybe...
Optane?
Well, he's got a nice 950 Pro. We'll talk about Optane soon. We can't talk about it yet, but... I don't know what I would... Yeah, I don't think it would be worth it.
No, it would not. It's not worth it to buy a new motherboard. You'd have to buy new RAM because it's DDR4 now, and to buy the new processor. You wouldn't see enough of a gain to make all that worthwhile.
Yeah. The one caveat, if they're streaming to Twitch, right? You know, and you're having problems with your Haswell part doing it, but Haswell is still a damn good part, you know, so it's hard to recommend tossing that in the garbage to do more cores, unless you are doing video editing. But for gaming, no. No hard to reference. Oh, and last one, actually, this is from Leroy Knudsen Family. Loving this audio episode. I planted the Soundblaster flag early. Every desktop I've ever owned since 1985 has had a Soundblaster card. Is this actually from Soundblaster? I suspect he works there. I lived through IRQ conflicts. Oh, yeah, those were fun. With the Soundblaster ISA card and dual booting Windows. Oh, my God. Windows OS 2 computer. My old Soundblaster Live Platinum is in a box somewhere in the garage. Mine's on a shelf. When Windows 10 came along, I ran unofficial Soundblaster drivers for my present Soundblaster card for months until the official release came. Wow, this guy's hardcore. I'm also one of those folks who gets sick trying to do 3D. Oh, man. Okay. Side-scrollers only.
Nice. I've actually got a couple of Soundblaster devices and one external and one internal sound card that I've had for a while now, but it's gotten derailed by Ryze and Windows 10 and Radeon. Yep. But I'm going to be testing that as a gamer. Are sound cards worth it as a gamer, as someone who's always used motherboard audio? So hopefully I'll have that up here soon.
Okay, last question. We're going to let Sai take it out. Once
take
a
it
note,
out, Sai.
Do you recommend... Oh, yeah, this is a good one. Do you recommend flashing the 400 series GPU to get the 500 series performance? I personally say no. Would love to hear what you think.
Yeah, so that's pretty interesting. It popped up over the past day or two. Basically, the 480 and the 580 and the 470 and 570 are basically the same chip, right? So people are taking 580 BIOSes and flashing them on their 480 cards to basically transform it into a 580. Which sounds great. You get more performance, right? But there are a lot of caveats to that. I wouldn't rush out and do that because the new 580 cards use a lot more power and more voltage. And part of the problem with the first wave at least of 480s is that they couldn't overvolt much and they couldn't push that much more power. So if you have one of those cards and you flash this BIOS to it that suddenly jacks up the power usage and the voltage, there's a decent chance that you're going to have a very bad time. And if you're not using a graphics card that has dual BIOSes, it could be a very, very, very bad time if you have troubles reinstalling your original BIOS. So unless you really, 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 really know what you're doing, I would not whatsoever do that. If you are going to do that and you do really, really know what you're doing, I would only do it if you already have like one of the high end, super custom, very cooled RX 480s and you want to flash it with a BIOS from a high end, super custom, you know, RX 580. But you're getting into some potentially dangerous territories with that stuff.
And one thing I want to add too, because I do think this should be spoken. It's the unspoken overclocking rule. It's like, if you are going to take this risk and blow that hardware up, don't try to make it like, oh, it died, I don't know what happened, right? Because that's what everybody does. They bring it back to the store, they call up whoever makes the car and say, it just blew up, I don't know what happened. That's sort of like, you got to be honest about that. If you're going to take that risk and kill brick, whatever that is, don't put it over the hardware vendor. Just eat it yourself and be honest, at least. Like, hey, I killed the card, can you guys reflash this or something? So, which I'm sure they can do at the factory, but... Mm-hmm. A lot of people
are having success doing it, but I think there's a lot of risk there. And the 580 series uses so much more power and only gets that 3 or 4 frames per second that I don't think the risk to reward balance is there.
Or you could just print out a sticker and put it on the cart too. Yeah. All right, I think that's the last one. Oh my God, it's been an hour and a half. We are going to get yelled at.
I'm so hungry.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It's lunchtime here on the West Coast.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm going to take us out unless any...
Nope. Let's do it.
Okay, check back in 2 weeks for your fix of PC Talk and the Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher. Send questions, and I will read them within a reasonable amount of time. Please do not use subject line, I have an offer from Nigeria for you. To the Full Nerd at PCWorld.com. Once again, the Full Nerd at PCWorld.com. I will actually start checking it, not thinking it's spam. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with Brad Charkas.
Adios.
Elena Yee.
Bye, everyone.
And taking us out, Adam Patrick Murray.
Be cool. Be cool.
Don't tell me what to do.